Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Advantage Engineers Regional Director, Ron Bobiak.
Morning, everybody. We're very honored to be a sponsor of WIA and also to introduce these next two folks. As a regional director at Advantage Engineers, we're very proud to be a leader in the telecommunications industry. We specialize in turnkey professional services, and including site acquisition, A&E, construction management. For the past 10 years, we've been doing a lot of new site builds, a lot of fiber in the ground, small cells. And then in January, we merged with a California-based company to help provide services to all of our customers, coast to coast. We're really excited to be here and learn about upcoming trends like 5G, IoT, and learn from the industry leaders that are speaking today. So I know all of you are checking your phones at least 10 times a day, and it's obvious the need for our bandwidth is growing. So I'm very honored to introduce our next keynote. For the last 5 years, Michael O'Rielly has been an FCC commissioner after being nominated by President Obama in 2013. He's also joined by Mr. O'Rielly by Kathleen, excuse me. I got a frog in my throat. Apologize, guys. Mr. O'Rielly is joined by Kathleen Abernathy, special counsel at the law firm of Wilkinson, Barker, Knauer. She has an impressive background, which includes a successful career at Frontier Communications, and has also served a term as an FCC commissioner as well. Please help me welcome this impressive duo to WIA. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. It's really a privilege for me to be here this morning with the entire wireless industry and with Commissioner O'Rielly, who has been a commissioner since 2013. I think all of you know his impressive credentials and background before he was at the FCC in the Senate. But one of the things I like most about Commissioner O'Rielly, is that he means what he says and he says what he means. And then he embraces the nitty gritty details of statutory law and legislation. I love that. And you know, he's not coy, he doesn't obfuscate, and this is incredibly refreshing in a political appointee. And when discussing issues with Commissioner O'Rielly, he will clearly tell you where he stands, whether or not you really like that it's his final answer. So I think that's terrific, because then you can actually have a real dialogue. So it's certainly a privilege and a pleasure for me to be here today with Commissioner O'Rielly.
Well, thank you so much for having me. It's a pleasure to be back. I was here last year, here at WIA, and had a wonderful opportunity to meet so many people. And so we're happy to be back and run through some issues that may be of interest to everybody.
So I'm going to start with one of your favorite topics.
Okay.
That's 5G. In a recent speech, you said your goal is to secure the ability of U.S. industry to win the 5G race. You've talked a lot about how critical it is that the U.S. continue to lead in the wireless arena for jobs, for standards, for just global competitiveness. As you talk a little bit about this race, whether it's a sprint or a marathon, and
a little bit of both.
That's what I thought. And what worries you as you look at where we are? Because this has always been a sweet spot for the U.S., our leadership in wireless, and I think it is critical for the future. So,
well, it hasn't always been that sweet for us. We've had a moment where we weren't leading the world, and you look at 3G and some of the other countries we've changed our approach on 4G, and now we're the envy of the world. And that's why people look in other countries that I visited and met with other nations. They're very interested in taking the lead on 5G. They recognize the benefits for not only GDP, but they recognize what it means for standard setting and what it means for leading for the next 20 some odd years in wireless field and what the benefits you get from that. So there definitely, in my opinion, is a race. And our wireless providers are doing a wonderful job rushing ahead as fast as they can to deploy 5G. There's obviously debates on what is actual 5G, and we're working through the standards process. Some of that's been completed and much more work to be done. But in terms of, you know, having 5G, it is a race, and we are well positioned, in my opinion, to be very successful in that competition.
You've talked a little bit also about your concerns with other countries and industrial policy and what impact that might or might not have for the U.S.?
Well, it's no surprise that, you know, some foreign nations have a different government structure than the United States, and they're using government dollars backing a 5G play with billions and billions of citizen money that the United States does not. Private wireless companies raise dollars on the open market and compete amongst each other and also the world community. These other countries have a favored position, and if you have the bank of, you know, a sovereign wealth fund, or you have the size of you know, some of these big nations behind you, it makes deployment a lot cheaper. They can remove any barriers to your deployment because it's in their best interest to get a return on their situation. And so they have industrial policy. They have a goal in what they'd like to see happen, and you know the countries that I speak of. And they're driven for a particular reason, and we are, you know, approach it much differently and have different challenges because of that. And it's why our vision for how we capitalize and overall capitalism in the United States is so important for us, and it's so important that we win this race.
So you talked about private capital investment. Obviously, that's how we've always done it, and that means you need an environment that is. Provides the right incentives and the right opportunities. So let's talk a little bit about some of the work that you've been championing at the FCC about lowering barriers, whether they're at the federal level or the state level, because those are costs, those are barriers, those are delays that have an impact on the actual infrastructure that's necessary for 5G to happen.
Well, I first should say that my fellow colleague, Commissioner Carr, has been taking the lead on some of these wireless infrastructure issues, but I've been engaged for a number of years on the topic and have tried to not only articulate the problems, but also find solutions. And I'm happy to plug my work into his, and we're both working off of the framework that the BEAD Act, that the Chairman's Advisory Committee has been set up for purposes of taking and providing us recommendations on what the Commission should do. And so we've got a lot of activity in the coming months. Hopefully it's this summer. It's possible that could slip a little bit, but I'd like to see take action on state and local barriers to deployment in the next few months that would remove. We should applaud the good communities that are forward-leaning and want to see deployment within their communities. But we also have to exercise FCC authority to get those communities that are what I've been referring to as bad actors out of the way. They're preventing our goal, which is to get, and our obligation under the law, getting services to the American people. And so we've got two flavors of problems, in my opinion. One is the desire from some localities and states to extract as much financial wherewithal they can from a wireless company or wireless provider or deployment field to try and get as many dollars as they possibly can out of the structure, and that's problematic. And two, it is the either lack of process or slow process for approving the deployment and the installation of new technology that's needed in this space. And so those both models are running. Some are running both. Some localities are victim and causing problems on both sides of the equation. So we have a lot of work to do on our front, but it is incredibly important if we're going to get services out to the American people.
When we were talking backstage, you mentioned work with NARUC. What are the tools that the FCC has in this arena? Because there are some areas where you have clear jurisdictional authority, others where you may need to be persuasive, and others where you may need to work with other entities to try and move things in the right direction.
Well, I think, in fairness, so I've tried to be persuasive over the last many years on this topic. We've tried the nice approach. We've tried cajoling states to do the right thing and localities to do the right thing. It hasn't exactly worked in those instances that we've had increasing problems. So that is, you know, there's only so much goodwill you can, you know, expend on that side of the equation. For me, it is using our statutory authority provided by Congress to push bad actors out of the way and take affirmative action by the commission. I recognize that's problematic from those that are committed to federalism principles and letting local governments and state governments run their jurisdictions. But I've got a larger goal, and that is making sure that the citizens are served. And so we've got to work through those problems. So it is both. Mm-hmm. When I talk to the neighborhood folks, I mean, they're obviously aware that a number of their states have enacted statutes to preempt their local governments for that exact reason. Some of them are better than others. We have to try and figure out how best to work within that structure if possible. If not, we'll take our action accordingly. So we've tried the nice route. I think we're gonna have to take the aggressive route, and I'm completely comfortable doing so.
You know, it's interesting to me that some of the states and localities have not figured out that it's a lot of capital that has to be invested to build out all this new infrastructure. And not all states are created equal when it comes to how and where you invest your capital. And that appears to still not have been quite as persuasive as one might think.
Look, I get it. When I've listened to different deployment. I was just recently at a place and in a state, and the provider said that the local community wanted $4,000 per small cell to deploy and make operational. Economically, they said, well, we can't make that happen. We're going to go elsewhere instead. And the locality was completely fine with it. That can't be the answer.
That can't be right.
That can't be an acceptable answer to just say, well, go somewhere else and deploy somewhere else. That's fine by us. That's a terrible, terrible outcome. And I get it. It's a tough time to be in budget cycle in different states and localities. It's always tough to find dollars. I mean, I've been dealing with another issue unrelated, 911 fee diversion. They're taking dollars from 911 and either going to unrelated purposes or semi-related purposes when they shouldn't be doing that at all. So I get there's financial pressure. There's financial pressure everywhere. There's financial pressure in my own home. So I get that the budgets are tough everywhere we can be, but we can't be expecting the deployment of networks and then, you know, and expecting to say, I want to get as many dollars as I possibly can out of the deployment system. They're not cohabitive purposes, in my opinion, and we're going to have to work through those issues.
Well, you know, in addition to the infrastructure, of course, you have to have spectrum.
Yes.
And it seems like no matter how much is out there, there's always a demand for more. But the other great news is that previously undesirable or unused parts of the spectrum are now incredibly accessible, usable. And I know that you're leading the FCC's action on the 3.5 gigahertz band and the new Citizens Band radio service. So you want to reallocate, you want to clear, you want a market-based approach. Can you talk a little bit about two questions. One, critical use of spectrum. How do you get it to its highest and best use as quickly as possible? And then two, how do you create the framework for the reallocation? Because that's incredibly challenging.
Well, the first thing you should know is this commission is completely committed to that purpose. We are spending so much time on spectrum issues. We have a new Spectrum Frontiers item on this month's meeting. It actually corresponds with a commitment I got from this chairman, my good friend, that we would have additional bands added. These are in the high bands. And these will add to the portfolio of those that we've already made available. To answer your question, though, how do you work through those? Each band is a little unique. Each band has a little different, not only propagation, but they also have different incumbents that are in place, and we have to work through those issues. And the good part is technology, as you had indicated, has stretched our ability of what we can use. It used to be you had to be below 1, and then it was below 3, and it was below 6, and now we're below 24, and we're high above 24. We're doing new proceeding, it's over 100, above 95. And I know there's research going on 400. So we've stretched the ability that they all have different propagation characteristics, and that means we're working really hard on mid-band. We have a pretty decent portfolio of low-band, and we've put a ton of new bands available in the high bands or millimeter wave. It's the mid-bands where I'm spending a lot of my time. CBRS, you mentioned, that's a critical issue. That 150 megahertz, we're trying to make available as soon as possible in while respecting the incumbents that are there. And it's a very complicated process. We're pretty much down to one issue, and I've talked about this. It's really the geographic licensing size. I'm sorry I missed you yesterday. I know you had a whole day dedicated to CBRS, and some folks were talking about this. I'm sorry to have not been there, because I would have liked to hear your thoughts and the different presentations. But it is something we are working really hard to finalize. But I say there are two other bands that we're working really hard in mid-band. It's 3.7 to 4.2, the C-band piece. It's also 3.45 to 3.55, 100 megahertz there that the NTIA has been pushing to make available, and they're in the process of doing a feasibility study. So adding all of that up provides a pretty good wireless play in mid-band, in my opinion. So we're working really hard on those issues.
Well, because you know, when you look at spectrum, it is a natural resource. It's a limited natural resource. You need to allocate it to its highest and best use. But uses change over time. Demand changes over time. And I know that even when I, back when I was there and you were first looking at all this, and certainly today, that how you balance and juggle the tensions between the entities that have been there a long time, but maybe not highest and best use anymore, and how you transition it.
Well, I'll give you an example, and we have an open proceeding on this, so anyone's welcome to comment. 4.9 gigahertz, it's set aside for public safety. Only 3% of that's being used by public safety. The rest of it is sitting fallow. Now, how can that possibly be? It's been many years. There is no great plan. The equipment's been tough to build to that situation. So we're exploring, and one of the things that I pushed really hard with my colleagues is to explore whether we should reallocate that band. Public safety has a number of different bands, and FirstNet coming on board, then maybe 4.9 doesn't make any sense anymore for them to have that, and we can reallocate that, figuring out if there's interest in the private sector to make a go at it. But it is, to your point, it is reallocating, even though there's tough issues, right? Trying to figure out if public safety should be displaced or moved, balancing that with the fact they're only using 3%. I mean, that's really problematic. So that's the job we're tasked to do it, and the one you used to do.
So as the spectrum guru at the FCC, which is what I do call you, because you're very facile jumping around to the different bands and sort of seeing a vision of where everything is fitting together, what's the timeline you're looking at if you, in a perfect world, or even an imperfect world, as you look over the next year, year and a half, 2 years, what would you like to see happen to try and continue to keep momentum going forward with the band reallocations, yep, with freeing up spectrum and encouraging investment?
In the next 2 years, I'd like to have a solid mid-band play for wireless providers to be able to offer 5G or an advanced 4G service. And so that's the work I've already talked about, CBRS, C-band, and 3.45. High bands, we've got a number of bands we're getting ready to auction, and then we're going to add some new bands to the pot to make as much spectrum and push as much spectrum out in the marketplace as possible. We also have the obligation to figure, and I threw out 4.9 for you, is an example of something where what other bands are out there that are not being used today that we can reallocate. And so when I look out the next 2 years on spectrum policy, that's everything. That is making the effort that we already have ongoing, and then doing new scouting activities to find out where else we should go next. So when I meet with anybody on the space, I'm like, okay, where should we be looking at next? What band is not being used as it properly should? What should we do in that instance, and how can we do it best? I mean, we also have to satisfy not just the licensed side, but the unlicensed side. So making sure that those portfolios match up in a nice way because of the benefits that we recognize from unlicensed. So whether it's CBRS and unlicensed band, in the GAA there, or whether it's working through, and I've been really hard, really working hard to make 6 gigahertz available for unlicensed use. And the 5.9 band is a DSRC, if anyone has followed that conversation for the last 20 some odd years, it's not functional yet. So there are a lot of bands to be talked about, and a lot of work to do on this front, in my opinion.
So one of the benefits, I think, of being an FCC commissioner is you have incredibly smart, innovative folks coming in, chatting with you, talking about what's next. What's one of the things that you've been most intrigued with recently that this is, I didn't prep him with this one, but I know you've talked about millimeter wave and stuff like that. What have you been hearing that makes you think, wow, this is exciting?
You know, what I love about the job, and it's an old comment from an old boss of mine, that you know, the beauty of unlicensed is you don't know what it's going to be used for. And that's kind of where I think we're sitting on 5G. We don't know, we know what you potentially can get in terms of speeds and latency and capacity. And we know the technical functions that we think we can get out of the new standard. And we know that the wireless providers are definitely interested in making that available and pushing it forward as soon as possible, certainly within test markets, and then getting to the real field, and then getting out and stretching that market. So we know there's great interest. What's been harder to come by is what are the case scenarios? What are those? What is 5G going to be used for? It's just not your capacity. It's going to be, you know, there are going to be whole business models that we don't know today. And so people talk about autonomous vehicles, or they talk about telehealth. Yeah, I think those are, you know, really possibilities that will be, you know, need such capable, you know, need 5G's functionality. But there are so many other possibilities that we don't and can't imagine now, and that's the beauty of, you know, Silicon Valley and creative minds throughout the United States. They're going to, you know, have innovative ideas on what we can do and build those case models. So I don't mean to punt on your question, but I'm what's so interesting when people come into me and they'll say, I think we can do this with it, and I'm going to go down this path. And I go, good luck. You know, I wish you the best. You know, in our entrepreneurial spirit that you have, I wish you the best. But you might be right, you might be wrong, and someone else has got a better idea or a worse idea, and we're going to let the market flush it all out.
Well, then that's perfect, because I want you to close a little bit with why there is this regulatory humility that you have about the framework that you launch from the FCC as you've got all these entrepreneurs trying to figure out what they want to do with the spectrum.
Well, look, we have an important role at the Commission. We have a statutory obligation set by Congress. And so we respect our job, and I don't mean to dismiss it, but we're not entrepreneurs, and our job is to build an environment for those in this private sector to take the capital, to take the risk, to deploy the people, to hire the workers, to build the network, to make services available to consumers that hire more people. And this is this entire cycle that's a wonderful development of American capitalism. We only play a small part of that. We try to make sure that the regulatory environment is as best and in the best position it possibly can. We have different, you know, different opinions of how extensive that should be. Mine's probably a little smaller. My regulatory burden's probably a little smaller than some of my colleagues through the years. But we try our best to try and, you know, make a stable ground as we can, and work really hard to let the innovators, those that want it, that are going to put capital at risk and go do the hard lifting to be able to do so.
Well, I want to thank you for your commitment to public service. I want to thank you for your staff. They do an awesome job for you every day.
Very kind.
And it was really a privilege to spend time with you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your attention. Much appreciated.